Let's head to the headlines now. I see what the papers are saying across Nigeria this morning. And I have with me in the studio journalist Dare Odufo-Woko and lawyer Jide Ologun. Gentlemen, good morning.
Good morning.
Nice to see you. Great. Let's begin with the News Direct this morning. News Direct is where we start from. Ashura procession. Shiites defy police. Alleged killing of 12 members by the police. All right. That's what you see on the front page of the News Direct. Daily Times is next, and it talks about the 2020 budget. Daily Times says that the federal government projects 2.93% GDP and 7.634 trillion naira revenue. Okay, says deduction from 614 billion naira bailout funds to state begin this month. And no more salaries for MDAs not captured by the IPPIS from October. Okay, so many terms from so many governmental and bureaucratic terms in there. All right, from the Daily Times, let's go to the Blueprint now. Blueprint is talking about the presidential poll, and it says anxiety as tribunal rules on Buhari Atiku today. All right, anxiety as tribunal rules on Buhari and Atiku today. To the Nation now, the Nation newspaper focuses on it says Buhari to South Africa, stop attacks on Nigerians. That was an earlier headline, but today's one says ex-chief justice squeezed over $9.6 billion contract verdict. That is what the headline today says. And detectives debrief three senior lawyers and NPC subsidiaries chiefs interrogated. Well, that's what you see on the Nation newspaper. The Sun now is where we go next. Judgment day for Buhari Atiku. Tension as Presidential Election Petitions Tribunal delivers verdict today. APC, PDP, full of expectation. Okay, we'll wait to see how it plays out today. And everyone's waiting to see the outcome of it. That's what you see on the Daily Sun. Vanguard is next now. Vanguard says it dwells on the bailout and says pressure on states as federal government starts deductions. A cut's 2020 budget projections to 9.789 trillion naira. It reduces capital expenditure to 2 trillion naira and says fiscal challenges requires bold, decisive actions. And down part of the paper, which you may not see now, but it gives a breakdown of what the states state indebtedness to the federal government. All right. That's what you see on the Vanguard. The Guardian is the next now, and it's the last one for this morning. Shiites, police squabble over alleged killing of 12. We deployed minimum force, say security agents. All right. Gentlemen, I think that's where we start from. Yesterday, it was, in fact, they built up to yesterday, the Ashura procession. They said they were going to, the IMN movement said they were going to lead a procession, which is part of a religious rite or religious ritual across the world. But there was a directive by the police saying that whatever kind of procession will be illegal because the group has been proscribed. But the issue of whether Nigerians as religious people have the right under the constitution, Jide Ologun, I'm coming to you on this, whether they have the right to lead a religious procession and whether they stand proscribed and don't have the rights to. That debate is still on, even on the streets. Can you talk to us, where does this stand in the eyes of the law? They have the right, yes, but they were proscribed by legally proscribed, yes, it's been appealed, yes, but where does this stand right now?
If you check section 10 of the Nigerian constitution, 1999 as amended, it declares Nigeria as a secular state. And if you look at section 40, that gives you your fundamental right of association. So you can gather to worship for political reasons, for whatever reasons. But that also is subject to the fact that you must not disrupt societal peace. And that is where the defining line is. And if you look at the case of Shahid, when the members began to protest that their leader should be released in obedience to the court's judgment that he should be released on bail. But recall then that the president said, came out with an executive order that the respect for the rule of law will be subject to national
security.
All right. And that threw up a lot of. And Some have alleged that what happened was the fact that the procession became violent because of the approach. I'm coming to this most recent one now. Now, the Ashura procession takes place on the 10th day of the first Islamic month, which was 10th of September, because the grandson of Prophet Muhammad was killed in the Kabbalah battle. You know, so he's considered as a martyr. So it's a moment of mourning and things like that. So it was meant to be a procession. But because also on the 26th of July, 2019, the court in Nigeria proscribed the Shahid group because of the violent
movement.
Exactly. As a terrorist group. And that was in line with, if you look at the Terrorism Prevention Act of 2011.
Yes.
So right now, there is a confusion even came up. And the police had to come back to clarify that.
Okay.
We are not proscribing procession generally, but focusing on the Islamic
IMN.
Movement of Nigeria. Because not only the Shiites that recognize this, even the Sunnis also recognize it across the world.
All right, so in the eyes of the law, it stands proscribed until maybe otherwise when if the courts come out because they've appealed.
But the argument is it the procession or the violent activities? And in this case now, about 12 have been allegedly killed. So what are the rules of engagement?
Okay, let me bring it to Dari here. Dari, what the law says, and when the appeal taking to court and all of that, those are processes. But let us talk even about the issue of engagement, the process by which, there is a directive by government, don't do this for now. But citizens said, no, it is our right to do it. What do you take from that? I'm taking away from the law now, putting it on the doorstep of moral standing and society.
Even before we go away from the doorstep of the law, let's take a look at that. Yes, rights. But rights also come with responsibilities.
Oh, yes.
Your rights as a citizen also impose on you certain responsibilities.
Responsibilities and
obligations. And one of those major responsibilities and obligations is respect for the laws of the land. So where we expect the government to respect rule of law, citizens are also expected to respect laws of the land. The government said the organization is proscribed. And it is within the powers of the government to do that according to the laws of our land. So if you are a law-abiding citizen...
But they have appealed anyway.
Why don't you wait for the appeal? There are processes. An appeal does not in any way nullify a subsisting judgment. The lawyers are here.
Yes.
I mean, we've seen it in political... A judgment is passed. This governor is removed by the High Court.
Mm.
Then he appeals to the appeal court, and he remains governor. So the order that IMN is prescribed remains until otherwise stated by a court or a higher court of
competent jurisdiction.
So what the IMN put up yesterday was obviously flouting the laws of the land, and I don't expect that we will create new rules of engagement each time we have to deal with people who decide to take on the government. There are existing laws of engagement on how to deal with recalcitrant behaviors and how to engage people who would rather disobey the law flagrantly than obey it. So the police went out yesterday to ensure that the laws are not broken. How they go about it, of course, we'll be worried if they... But listening to the police authorities, they used
minimum force.
Well, I want to believe them because they arrested. The IMM members are saying they killed. But if you go out armed, or if you go out violently,
yes,
and with a record of, previous clashes have proven that there could be a death on both sides. So the police will also go out prepared to defend themselves. In the process of self-defense, anything could, I mean, happen.
All right. Well, it is their word against the police and police against them when they claim that the police killed 12 of their members and the police said nothing like that happened. It's all right. Thank you very much, Dario Odufo-Walker, for coming on the program. Jide Logun, thank you very much for coming.
God bless Nigeria.
Thank you. Right.
All right, let's head straight to the papers now. We'll be looking at stories from the front pages of newspaper headlines this morning. And I have in the studio journalist Dario Odufo-Walker and lawyer Jide Ologun. Thank you, gentlemen, for coming on TVC Breakfast. So let's head straight to the papers now. And I start with the Daily Trust. Buhari Atiku no fate as tribunal rules today. APC, PDP speak on expectations. And on the front page of News Direct, Ashura procession shacks the five police alleged killing of 12 members by police. And to the front page of the Daily Times, 2020 budget, federal government projects 2.93% GDP, 7.634 trillion naira revenue, says deduction from 614 billion naira bailout funds to states begins this month. No more salaries for MDAs not captured by IPPIS for October. To the front page of the Blueprint presidential poll, anxiety as tribunal rules on Buhari Atiku today. And on the front page of The Nation, ex-chief justice quizzed over $9.6 billion contract verdict. Detectives debrief three senior lawyers and NPC subsidiaries chiefs interrogated. On the front page of the Daily Sun, judgment day for Buhari Atiku, tension as presidential election petitions tribunal delivers verdict today, APC, PDP full of expectation. On the front page of the Vanguard, bailout pressure on states as federal government starts deductions, cuts 2020 budget projection to 9.78 trillion naira, reduces capital expenditure to 2 trillion naira, says fiscal challenges requires bold, decisive actions. And finally, on the front page of The Guardian, Shiites police squabble over alleged killing of 12 with deployed minimum force, says security agents. Well, gentlemen, we'll be looking at the front page of The Vanguard, pressure on states as FG starts deductions, and the deductions would start this month. I'm wondering, how much pressure do you envisage as Deputy Judy?
Given the fact that the implementation of the minimum wage
is
still being discussed, I think this is going to be a huge burden on the states. But having said that, I think there's a brilliant opportunity now to look at the revenue drive of the states. There is no state in Nigeria that is not endowed with huge resources. So this is the time for resourcefulness. And of course, nationally speaking, you can see that the proposed budget is going to be lifted in terms of recurrent expenditure, while on capital expenditure it reduces, for example, to about 2 trillion naira. And the big question is that why don't we invest in infrastructure? For example, if we can bring our refineries back to shape, that we can save the 11
but
trillion naira.
But these are the
naira.
Things we keep talking about year in year.
Yeah, that's, you see, it's now said that we have to be decisive about it. It's all about action. We've always had these, statistics showing us that we are heading for the Red Sea economically. But when will this action start? Because so you expect that we should be moving in that direction.
If we say that it starts with action, who begins this action? Someone has to trigger it.
Let me ask this simple question. Let's assume we are dealing with the private sector investment platform, and you have four refineries that can make you the richest in the world, and it is managed in a way that you are crawling under a huge debt burden and resources drainage. What will you do? What will you do? You discontinue that process and launch a fresh process.
And that was why we came up with the modular refineries.
Now, the next question is, let's assume we started building the modular refineries in 2015. And by now we have about 20 states with modular refineries, and we have stopped importing fuel into this country. That means the 11 trillion naira that has been wasted on subsidy the last 6 years would have been retained within the economy. And that also reduces our desperation to go and
start borrowing. Right now, my great nation is owing about 25 trillion naira. So who is going to pay for all this? There is no evident infrastructural manifestation to justify this huge indebtedness.
Now, that leads me to my next question, and it goes to you, Dai. When you look at the pressure on the states, some of the states with the highest burden are Osun, Delta, Ogun. And when you look at the developments in this state, is how much pressure, beyond the pressure, how much impact has all of these bailout funds made to the states? And now that they have to pay back, who is going to be at the brunt?
When the bailout came, it was meant for a purpose. Offset debts in the area of salaries, other emoluments, and pension areas. How many of these states today are no longer owing those debts in question? That's that's something we all know the answers to. Many of the governors put the money to other uses. The purpose for which it was released were actually not fulfilled in full. Now it's time to repay. I think when we talk about pressure, yes, the pressure will come because this is going to be like, I know the FG, they'll take it from source. We borrowed you, we have to take it back from source. So they'll be left with whatever is sent to them. It's the people in the long run that will bear the brunt again. Because the emoluments of political office holders will not be affected by this. We know the style, unfortunately. The governors will still get their huge security votes. That is not questioned by anybody.
Is this why they are not thinking outside the box when it comes to revenue generation?
Where we begin to really determine the political fate of political office holders during the election by what they achieved, they begin to think outside the box. In Nigeria today, a politician believes either he performs or not, he can always win, seek and win re-election. And that is why he spent 4 years marking time in office, doing nothing. You see a governor that is widely acclaimed, not only in the country, even outside the country, that this governor has not performed. And he goes into the primary election of his political party, and he comes out top, not just winning with unimaginable margin to people who have not been tested. He has been tested. He is known to have not performed. But he goes ahead and wins. Then he goes into the general election and he returns impressive figures being re-elected. And the evidences are there that here is a man who didn't perform. How do we perform such magics? We do it because we don't judge our political office holders by their performances. So when I know all I need to do is start some money somewhere, get some thugs to be on the street, and I win election. If I don't think very well and perform, either the money is there or not, I'll lose.
But it seems there's some sort of revolution in that aspect where Nigerians are beginning to ask questions.
And that is why we are seeing what we are seeing now. That's why we are seeing governors who are beginning to... You see, we must give credit to some governors. Even among these new ones who came in and they're sitting down without trying to do PR for anybody, you take a look at somebody like the governor of Ogun State who spent his first 100 days looking at what can be done to improve the earnings of the state.
But now
you want to look at somebody like the governor in Oyo State who feels, look, let us look at those basic issues like education, like health, affecting the people.
But now, but looking at all of that, as much as we commend them, there are implications to these deductions. A lot of it.
Yes, and that is why that's why I'm agreeing what you are saying, that this is the time for these governors to think outside the box.
So what are the implications?
The implication is that if you don't embark on a deliberate effort to develop this nation and develop the people, we may find ourselves with the kind of embarrassment that is going on in Sudan, in South Africa, because the essence of governance is to develop the people, you know, make the facilities available, create enabling environment that we attract prosperity. Poverty can only move us to a particular direction, and it's the direction of destruction. So we will advise those who have the privilege now to be resourceful, like we have said here. Look at your state. Look at Kogi State, for example. The massive raw materials for producing cement. Look at the fact that we have the largest deposit of proven gas in Africa. Look at the several, look at Zamfara State that has the capacity to generate $2 billion monthly from gold, but bandits have taken over. So when we look at this and restructure our business mentality, I mean, we rise and shine, but when we settle down for,
sort of
let's
pressure.
Just spend the money on pleasure, on the status of office,
and
you know, so.
And now, the federal government too will have to, devolve some powers to the states. The certain areas of the economy should be rearranged in such a way that the states can also make some money from
this
exclusive thing. We beat it down, allow the states to grow too. The allowing a transition from federal down should be looked into. I think the resources should come from bottom up. Get the resources, then send whatever should go to the center. This will help states perform better. And some states that looks like they're not viable now, by the time we do that, we'll realize that, they can also survive on their own.
All right, gentlemen, thank you for your contribution on the newspaper review this morning.
Nigeria.
All right.
Let's see what the headlines are across the papers right now. And we have in the studio Dario Dufo-Oko and Jide Ologun. They'll be joining me right now. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for coming.
Good morning.
Thank you. Now, let's start with the Daily Trust. Daily Trust says, Buhari Atiku no fate as tribunal rules today. APC PDP speak on expectations. Okay, that's Daily Trust. From there, let's go to the News Direct. And it focuses on the Ashura procession. Shiites defy police, alleged killing of 12 members by the police. That's what you see on the News Direct. Daily Times is where we go next, and it focuses on the 2020 budget. Federal government projects 2.93% GDP and 7.634 trillion naira revenue. Says deduction from 614 billion naira bailout funds to states begin this week. No more salaries for MDAs not captured by the IPPIS from October. All right, that's the Daily Trust. Let's go now to the blueprint. The blueprint is dwelling on the presidential poll. Anxiety as tribunal rules on Buhari Atiku today. Everyone's waiting for that and so on. Let's move now to the Nation. Ex-Chief Justice squeezed over $9.6 billion contract verdict. Detectives debrief three senior lawyers and NMPC subsidiaries chief interrogated. You find that on the front page of the Nation newspaper. Let's go now to the Daily Sun. The Daily Sun is next now, and it says, Judgment Day for Buhari Atiku. Tension as Presidential Election Petition Tribunal delivers verdict today. An APC PDP full of expectations. We'll wait for that. From there, let's go to the Vanguard newspaper. Vanguard newspaper is dwelling on the bailout, and it said pressure on states as federal government starts deduction and cuts 2020 budget projections to 9.789 trillion naira, reduces capital expenditure to 2 trillion naira, and says fiscal challenges requires bold, decisive actions. That's the Vanguard. All right, the Guardian is next now, and it says Shiites police squabble over alleged killing of 12 of the members, and we deployed minimum force, is security agents. That's what you see on the front page of the Guardian. All right, gentlemen, you'll be interested in the story on the Daily Times that dwells on the 2020 budget. Now, we see a lot of activity right now by government trying to return the budgetary year cycle from January to December. And so much activity is going on. The National Assembly has sent out a message saying, we are ready, submit the budget estimate and projection by September. We'll be ready to pass everything in December so that the year can start and so on. Dario, what do you make of this?
A good development, I would say, especially because this is something a lot of people have been clamoring for before now. To
know that by, this is September, we have at least a projection, even with figures attached as to what the 2020 budget will look like. It's a good development. And however, one will be more pleased if by January the budget has been passed. So between the presidency and the National Assembly now, we have the whole of September, October, November, December to get this thing done. It's high time we actually return to this January to December budget cycle, because by the time we get our budget signed in May, June, and we have just 6 months to go, and we always have on our hand a situation where the other year, people don't really know when the financial year started. The Nigerians, especially those who rely so much on the budget to carry out their yearly activities are usually stranded.
Yearly projections, yeah.
The projections, the lack of the budget in good time affects their own projections.
Okay.
So it's a good development, but implementation, execution, and seeing this through will really take it home to Nigerians as something we should
Talking about implementation, GD, there are lots of concerns that the 2019 budget has not really been implemented to a great extent. In fact, if you place it based on percentage, so many Nigerians have different ratings for it. But some say it hasn't even been implemented because it's just been passed a few months ago.
You know, budget itself is a projection that anchors on revenue drive and how you spend the money. And basically, we have not seen the requisite result to justify our budgets over the year, you know, over the years, because if we have an effective, by now we should not be the capital of poverty. So, and I'm worried, like I expressed earlier, that even the 2020 projected budget is having a bloated recurrent expenditure. And recurrent expenditure is what goes into the air. Capital expenditure is what develops the country towards sustainable development. And this time around, that is even coming down. And there are several sectors when you come to management by objective and returns on investment. Our health sector, with all we have budgeted, how is it? The education sector, how is it? Provision of water for the people, provision of food for the people,
electricity,
security of the people, electricity, industrialization effort. So, and these are things that should bother us. Talking about the circle, it's good to tie with January, December, but it's not really about the circle, but what we achieve. Whether we hit the ground running from June to whatever, what have we achieved? And the reports we are getting is quite worrisome. For example, what is the position of our excess crude account? How much are we wasting on subsidy? How much are we spending on insurgency, on banditry? What about all the leakages? Because budget expects that in your revenue drive, you prevent all these leakages. So economically speaking, we have not done well at all, and we can do better. But like the Chinese, we always say, the best time to have planted a tree was 20 years ago. Best time is now.
Is now.
Because you look at what will be used to purchase vehicle. You know, it's about how you manage your resources.
Okay. The issue of management is very critical here, Dari. If you look at the model that Ethiopia is using, or even Rwanda, we are in faraway Nigeria from those countries. And the report from the country we hear, and people who have been visiting, we have been visiting, people have been visiting, there are others who are visiting, and they're seeing tangible results of what government is putting on ground. Do we have a peculiar issue in Nigeria that we're not able to see those kind of tangible results for now?
Yeah, here in Nigeria, you see, what you have seen happening in those countries is not about what they wrote on paper and called budget.
Okay.
It's not about what they went on national TV to reel out to the hearing of the people and called projections. It is about the resolve of certain people in those systems to ensure that these policies these projections we have put on paper that we have all agreed are good for our people and for our countries, we are going to see to the implementation of this thing. So it's about the people. It's about those implementing these policies. It's about those who will work to see the budget all through the year pan out well. So the problem with us, without trying to hide behind the finger, we're talking about Rwanda, we've spoken about Ethiopia. Lately, it's now about Ghana. Now we talk of South Africa, where we are being chased every day. If we are talking about these places, we should not just talk about the system they practice. We should talk about the kind of leadership they have, the kind of followership too. So it's the people. A people, it makes the country. If the people, both the leaders and the followers, are resolved to make their system work, it will work. In Nigeria, we have a budget. We are going to have policies to drive,
The
that
budget. All right.
Are we all going to submit ourselves to the goodwill of that of those policies? Are we not going to grumble when a policy goes against our party's personal interest?
Right.
These are the things that will make the budget
all
work
right.
out.
So well. we have a long way to go, but they're surmountable anyway. Yeah. One would say that. Thank you very much, Dario Odufo-Wokon, for coming on the program. Jide Ologun, thank you very much.
God bless Nigeria. Right.